is Jim with an intro to remind you to man, was that... How did I turn into Andrew Dice Clay all of a sudden? That was bizarre. Anyway, hi. I'm here to remind you about NowPlayingNetwork.net, where you can find a variety of fantastic podcasts that I wholeheartedly support. So, if you feel so inclined, there's also a donation link over at NowPlayingNetwork.net. Throw a few bones our way to help pay for server fees and whatnot, and you will most likely get a special treat in the mail. I'm toying around the possibility of going Patreon, simply due to the fact that I'll be taking some time off from my job next month and could use a little help. But again, this is not something I'm going to impulsively just decide on overnight. It's something I'm just considering. But in the meantime, I would like you to check out the latest episodes, including supporting characters, because yours truly was just interviewed by friend and recent guest Bill Ackerman. Well, he's frequent guest, I should say. And he does a wonderful job putting these episodes together, so give them your time and attention, and you'll get to learn about why I am such a movie nerd. It's a bi-weekly podcast that I hope you have already subscribed to, because if you're a fan of this show, there's a strong possibility you might enjoy the interviews that Bill conducts with a lot of fantastic talent. You'll also learn a lot from a wonderful new podcast that is 4 episodes in now. It is Tracks of the Damned from Patrick Rapole. His last 2 episodes were on films I happen to think are pretty underrated. Oculus and Lake Mungo in particular. And if you download the Lake Mungo episode, you'll hear a surprise contribution that I made that I'm pretty proud of. And I'm glad that it complimented Patrick's incredible insights as always. So do subscribe to Tracks of the Damned. And in addition, we got Movie Madness. That's going to return later this week. I assume Vinyl Emergency will also be returning this week or the next. In the meantime, check out Fresh Perspective, hosted by Rebecca and Jeff. Their latest episode is on a film that is chock full of elements to parse and mull over. And that would be Sidney Lumet's very heralded Network. So, speaking of network, visit NowPlayingNetwork.net. And one final plug here. I encourage you to go to thegreatalbumspodcast.com, since I made an appearance on Bill and Brian's wonderful podcast called The Great Albums, in which they do a track-by-track analysis of records they think are really great. I'll include a link in the show notes, of course, but I had the distinct pleasure of talking about my favorite album of all time, which is Exile in Guyville by Liz Phair. It was a real joy. It was a real joy talking with those guys and sort of dissecting the career of Liz Phair, as well as going through the entire album and sort of capturing our initial responses to each song. And her music means so much to me to this very day. Exile has a special place in my life in general. So I hope you will check out this episode and many others to come. We've got some great shows coming your way, more guest appearances, and more Directors Club coming your way! So fill up your iPods, your iPhones, your Pokemons, your Walkmans, your Kindles, your Spindles, your hard drives with all of this wonderful content that I hope you enjoy. And speaking of enjoyment, I loved talking about Alex Cox, a director I was fairly familiar with based on only two films of his that I've seen, probably the films he's most known for. And I had checked out a few more, of course, for this episode, obviously, and it was one title in particular, Highway Patrolman, that my excellent guest, Philip O'Neill, suggested that I check out right before we recorded, and I did. But it's also on the suggestion for my favorite director, Paul Thomas Anderson, who a couple years ago showed scenes from some of his favorite movies at the New York Film Festival, I believe, and it included Repo Man, which is a film I've always loved, and I briefly included a quick clip of PTA talking about that particular film and his perspective on it. It's just it's a special film in so many ways that we dive into right off the top after the intro here with Philip. So I hope you enjoy this conversation, and here's an episode about British cult director Alex Cox.
Oh, Diet Pepsi, what's all calorie? Now you see it, now you don't.
Diet Pepsi, buy it, cause you're a consumer.
Everyone, and welcome to the Directors Club Podcast. I am Jim Laskowski. This episode is brought to you by Crystal Meth Pepsi. Pepsi is not only the choice of a new generation, but it is made from 100% real sugar for healthy teeth, bones, and tissue. So you can't beat the refreshing taste of Crystal Meth Pepsi. And with that, I'm excited to talk to a newcomer, a guest that I've mostly just chatted with digitally via Facebook Messenger, but I couldn't be more thrilled. I've spoken with a number of guests from Canada and potentially some other countries.
Drink Pepsi.
But this is the first time I've had somebody on from Sweden. I would like to welcome Philip O'Neill.
Hello, Jim. Thank you for having me.
So off the top of my head, my guess is that Sweden has way better healthcare than we do?
Yes. Yes.
Okay, that's what
and
I think.
And Canada too, right?
Yes. Yes. So in the midst of this recording, you were in production on a short film, if I'm not mistaken. But since you're new to the show, just tell me more about your creative endeavors or what turned you into a film fanatic, or you know, you want to be a filmmaker in your own right. So just to give a little background.
Well, you know, my love for film, difficult to say where it exactly started. I mean, I grew up with movies, of course, like anybody else.
Sure.
You know, with VHS, and my father, he's a film lover. He introduced me to a lot of old films, like the Bond films and Jerry Lewis comedies. I've always enjoyed, like, classic films from, like, go back to the 70s. I was never somebody who was like, oh, no, I don't want to watch a black and white film, you know. I was always fascinated by anything that I would see on TV,
mm-hmm.
Or, you know, VHS, whatever. My father had, what do you call it, recorded certain movies on VHS, I guess you could call it.
Sure.
Yeah. So I would, like, go through the shelf and find, like, all these different films there. And my sister also really enjoyed films. And it was especially, like, got into horror films. That was one way of kind of exploring is also the, you know, older films.
Yeah, looking at your blog, I noticed that you're a huge fan of just genre films and horror films in particular. You wrote about them in the past.
Oh, yeah, and I actually hated horror films when I was a kid. You know, they gave me nightmares.
Yeah.
But then I saw something like Fright Night by Tom Holland.
Nice.
And that was just like, what the hell is this? This is funny. This is like subversive, and it's, you know, it's about a kid who watches horror movies and discovers his neighbor's a vampire.
Easy to relate to, then.
Yeah, it was really unusual, and that was fun. I was, like, not cowering behind my couch or something. It was just... So after that, and I started watching... and then another film I saw, which, believe it or not, was Jason X, which...
Oh, wow.
Yeah, I saw a commercial for that film on TV. Some guy sitting in a dark room, and then he looks into a mirror, and there's the hockey mask. And I went, wait a minute, I recognize that. Hockey mask. Where have I seen that? You know, because Jason's like parodying every single cartoon or whatever, comic books. So I would watch Jason X, and I was like, oh my God, what the hell is this? I have to see more of this. So I tracked down Jason X on DVD, watched the film, and there's this special feature on there called The Many Lives of Jason Voorhees, where they would have, like, it was this documentary where I had like Joe Bob Briggs and all kinds of horror gurus talking about the genre, older films. And I was just, like, fascinated by this. Like, at some point, like, all these different slasher titles will come up on the screen. My Bloody Valentine's Day and, you know, April Fool's Day, all these titles. And I was like, whoa, what? It's like a whole new world, you know, opening up. So I was just, I got to watch more of these films, as old as they are, you know.
Yeah.
And at some point, I started to develop an interest in, well, other genres, not just horror. And I can't remember exactly when that was, but I'm, of course, I'm also part of the DVD generation. And over the years, I've just had a very, I guess you might call it, an unhealthy obsession with cinema. It's just, it's my favorite art form. I think it's the ultimate art form, actually.
I can completely agree with that. I mean, as much as I love music and composing mm-hmm. music, it's just an amalgam of all these different elements coming together that just speak to me every time.
Yeah, it's a mix of images,
sound.
Yeah, music and literature, architecture, all these different things, and acting as well is, I think, an art form. It's an amazing medium. Unfortunately, not the norm doesn't think so, you know, because movies are, it's so mainstream. So many people enjoy it, and the more sort of arty kind of films, more unusual films, are kind of something that only film geeks, you know, like us, maybe.
So you also got into editing at some point, because I looked up here, and you were writing a lot for your Swedish Cinemasochist blog, and you were mentioned on the Clive Barker cast.
Mm-hmm.
That's interesting to me, because Nightbreed is a movie that has kind of a special place in my heart. I don't think it's a great film, but it's funny because that's where my first band in high school, that's how we got our name, Midian. and so, you know, there's certainly a lot of things I do love about that movie, including just casting David Cronenberg and all sorts of stuff, but I see that you put together a fan edit of your own at some point.
Yeah, fan editing is something I started with a long time ago. I think I was trying to fix Rob Zombie's Halloween or something. And then I started working on Hellraiser 2. And then I wanted to try and reconstruct Exorcist 3, actually. Try to recreate Blatty's original cut of that film.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, which someone else actually did. So I kind of left mine on the shelf. And now they're releasing a director's cut. Scream Factory is releasing a director's cut.
Oh, nice. Yeah, I got to pick that up. I'm a big fan of Exorcist 3.
Yeah, I was fascinated by that film. When I picked up the book, Legion, to read that. But Nightbreed was a film that was a film I just instantly fell in love with. It was just so out there, so wild and fantastical. And And of course, I wanted to see a director's cut, which took a long time. Before that, there was this cabal cut, this edit put together by friends of Clive Barker. Saw that at a convention in Germany. And I was like, well, the quality wasn't that good, but you know, if they can just, they're going to restore it, it's going to be great. And then I saw the director's cut, and I was quite disappointed by it, because it's like, where is all the stuff that I saw in the cabal? Where all the, like, it has the original ending, but there's still things missing that makes that ending work for mm-hmm. me. So At some point I just started to work on this sort of reconstruction of the film using a program called Sony Vegas Pro 13.
Ooh, I'm a big fan of Sony Vegas, actually. I know a lot of people, you know, sing the praises first Final Cut Pro, and then it was Adobe Premiere.
Oh, yeah.
But I've been using Sony Vegas for a while, actually.
Yeah, it's pretty good. It's and if you bought Nightbreed on Blu-ray, the limited edition, there are all this deleted scenes on there, like outtakes, something mm-hmm. like that. And I looked at all this stuff, going like, "Wow, there's so much here." You know, I could maybe do something with this. And I started out just gonna do like maybe a 20-minute thing or something, but then I decided, you know what, I'm going to try and maybe get a hold of those work prints. And I contacted the editor who did the cabal cut, and I told him what I wanted to do. And he was like, sure, take him, do it. I mean, where's the harm in that? And he sent me two work prints that were over 2.5 hours long. And it was amazing for a fan of like myself, because it was the movie completely uncut, basically. So it was like, it was work prints. So scenes extended, you know, in their full length. And I could basically go through the scenes and edit them to my liking, and recreate a whole new version of the film that had a different pace to it. But I still want it, of course, to work as a film and not feel like a bloated fan edit. But it's different from the director's cut, I would say, in that it's just kind of, it broadens certain aspects of the story, and certain the main characters are, I think you feel more for them now. I love Cronenberg in the part, but Cronenberg's character is, if you read the book that it's based on, he's a slightly different character in the book than how he was ultimately presented. The studio cared more about the Cronenberg character. You might know about this, that they were more interested in the slasher.
Right.
Which is funny because Cronenberg, Clive Barker, was so tired of slasher films by that point. He wanted to make, because he was like, he loved monster films. He wanted to bring back the monster genre. And the reason why there's a slasher character, because it's kind of Clive Barker kind of fighting the slasher genre, you know.
Oh, so yeah, that makes sense.
Yeah, and he wanted to kill it off at the end and kind of go, all right, fuck off. Now let's make monster films. Unfortunately, the studio said, no, the monster genre doesn't work, you know. What people want to see is obviously Friday 13, so let's bring him back at the end. And Clive Barker was, of course, kind of destroyed by that. Kind of a shame. And he wanted to make it a Star Wars of horror films. He wanted to make a trilogy films. And, you know, I like to think that somewhere there's a parallel universe out there where we got all these great Nightbreed sequels and none of those bad Children of the Corn sequels, you know?
that's a good point. That's really interesting. Just, you know, my former co-host Patrick and I, we saw the Cabal cut on the big screen. But even the footage they incorporated into it was really, you could tell immediately when they cut to footage that was on a different reel, or the quality deteriorated.
Yeah, I had two workprints, and the one workprint actually looks better than that one you've seen.
Yeah, okay.
The Cabal cut, they only used the one workprint, which was the longest version, which I understand why they used it, but it had worse, the quality was worse.
It clearly must have been an influence on Guillermo del Toro, because some of the creatures that del Toro's come up with are similar to Barker.
Yeah, you know, it's funny. I know he's a fan of Clive Barker, but I've searched everywhere for Nightbreed and Del Toro, and I can't find a single interview with Del Toro where he talks about Nightbreed, which is bizarre.
It is.
So strange.
Well, maybe we'll save that conversation for next year another time, because it'd be interesting to talk about Clive Barker, even though he's only made a few films.
Do you want to watch Rawhead Rex?
Yeah, why not? We're here today, though, to talk about an incredible director. We're going to be talking about Alex Cox, and I've been a huge fan of Repo Man for a long, long time, and been very curious to learn more about him. Yeah. There's so much to talk about in regards to, I mean, even just the three main films, I guess you would consider his most essential, or at least the ones that people know him for, which are Repo Man, Sid and Nancy, and Walker.
Yes, I would also maybe say Highway Patrolman, because it also represents a shift in his sort of filmmaking style.
Yeah. Yeah. No. Now that I've seen it. Which I'm very happy about. I can sense that he went in a different direction. I mean, Walker was a huge bomb critically, box office wise.
And he was basically blacklisted.
Yeah,
he was supposed to do The Running Man, actually, and they wouldn't let him because of Walker.
Yeah, so. See, that's interesting to me. I could see him doing like a Stephen King adaptation or RoboCop, for example.
Yeah. It's funny, it's because the guy who wrote RoboCop was actually, I think, the cinematographer on his first student film, Michael Miner. So,
wow.
Yeah. Yeah.
Small world.
Another studio, I mean, he tried to get back into the studio system in the 90s with something like The Winner, but that just didn't work. That was, of course, recut, and his version is sort of not really available to see. But he also was going to make Marsh Attacks.
Oh, my God. That's bizarre.
That would have been interesting.
Well, that's a good segue into his debut film with Alien. nuts.
Yes.
I always try. Yeah. I always try to figure out a way to make the conversation a little bit more seamless. But, wow. Yeah, you know, in 1984, this British director, and he was self-proclaimed as a radical filmmaker, managed to get the backing of a monkey, Michael Nesmith, and also got some help from Universal Studios as well to make what I would consider to be one of the great American satires.
A lot of people don't realize what's really going on. They view life as a bunch of unconnected incidents and things. They don't realize that there's this, like, lattice of coincidence that lays on top of everything.
The punk movement had a lot of songs that were anti-Reagan, a lot of protest songs and concerts throughout the country. And that sentiment sort of fueled Cox to make this story into something bigger and more fully realized. I mean, he definitely wanted to pay homage to early sort of nuclear paranoia films and for the 80s, essentially.
Yeah, and also maybe a little bit of Kiss Me Deadly.
Yeah, yeah, for sure, with the glowing trunk. Yeah, which, of course, Tarantino would later use himself. But, you know, you could tell watching this how much he's influenced a lot of my favorite directors, like Tarantino and Paul Thomas Anderson. Just that sort of go-for-broke nature and weird choices throughout that don't seem forced. They seem fully realized in this universe that Cox has created here.
Well, you know, he is... I read somewhere somebody said, like, he is to filmmaking what punk is to rock and roll.
Yeah. I can see that.
Yeah, he's so... that's the word I'm looking for. Anarchist.
Anarchic, I guess.
Yeah, anarchic, I think.
Yeah.
He's so innocent. I mean, I watched this film, and I'm a big fan of his, but I'm trying to figure out what is his style, really, because it's so wild. You know, it's... You think, okay, you got him down, but then suddenly he makes another film, completely entire, you know, different film.
Yeah, he's definitely one of those directors that sort of debunked the auteur theory, and that I mean, there's elements, clearly, that you can pinpoint throughout each of his films that you can say, well, that... Maybe just that sort of social critique or political critique of America is kind of prevalent throughout most of his films.
Oh, yeah. It's very evident through Walker, especially. There.
Yeah. Yeah. That's it's pretty much holding up protest signs throughout that entire movie, which is not a problem, in my opinion, because we'll get to that. But I think what's also fascinating is the fact that, you know, he's pretty, for being sort of this rebellious punk anarchic filmmaker, he does have he chooses to employ the cinematographer for Paris, Texas for this film. So you get interesting shots of barren landscapes and, you know, just how alienating that could be for certain individuals like Otto, played by Emilio Estevez here, which is definitely his best role, for sure.
It must be.
Yeah.
What I've seen of it. Probably his most, I mean, definitely his, as far as films goes, is probably his best film as well.
Yeah, I would think so. I mean, I didn't really follow his career.
What happened to it? Did Maximum Overdrive kill it?
Yeah, either that or Men at Work. Yeah, like I said, the cinematography in this is kind of amazing. As I'm watching this on Blu-ray, I'm just kind of like, yeah, this... It's funny to see the great Harry Dean Stanton in the same year, no less, in one of my top five favorite movies, Paris, Texas, and then this, where he's playing a very vocal character, just sort of taking the role of mentor for Otto, that I just adore.
I shall not cause harm to any vehicle, nor the personal contents thereof, nor through inaction let that vehicle or the personal contents thereof come to harm. It's what I call the repo code, kid. Don't forget it. Etch it in your brain.
Do you know who was the original choice for that?
Was it Dennis Hopper?
Yes, that's right. Dennis Hopper, because he was a big... Alex Cox was a big fan of Dennis Hopper.
So yeah, he looks a lot like the main guy at the beginning. I forgot the actor's name. You know, he's driving the Chevy with the quote-unquote alien-slash-glowing...
yes, which is an amazing opening sequence.
As soon as
you're like, wait a minute, what the hell is this? you're grabbed right away. You know, you just want to see where is this going? What's happening? This was your exposure to Alex Cox, right?
Yeah, you saw it, absolutely.
Yeah, for me too. Yeah,
I rented this with my friends, and we loved it. I mean, this is a very quotable movie. To where I know, you know, it's like, I don't know how many times we were trying to decide what to eat, and of course we would go, let's go get sushi and not pay for it.
Yeah,
you know.
Yeah, let's go get sushi and not pay.
Everything about this movie, I respond to either in this, you know, comedic satirical light, or as a filmmaker, as an editor, the cinematography, because I love the portrayal of Los Angeles like this. And I think that's why Paul Thomas Anderson actually cited this as an influence for Inherent Vice, in the way it captures like this sort of grungy neon lit city at night, just like the sort of the underground Los Angeles, the less glamorous side of it.
As it is, like, very familiar. I saw burned out hippie parents and kids, new guys like this with flat tops and the shirt tied around their waist in the suburbs of the San Fernando Valley, and kind of punk rock and kind of not, and kind of, you know, aimless and sort of product of hippie parents who weren't paying attention. So that's one element of this movie that I guess ties into Inherent Vice. But tabling that direct thing in this scene, there is such abandon in this movie, but it's focused, it's funny, it's outlandish. I mean, it's just kind of brilliant.
And I'm so taken with the scene where he first goes home and talks to his parents.
What, they're watching some religious...
Yeah. The evangelist on TV says something like, I do want your money because God wants your money. So I want you to go out and mortgage that home and sell that car and send me your money. You don't need that car.
Thankfully, we don't have that kind of shows in Sweden.
No, you don't. I hope they're not as prevalent as they were back then. I would hope not, because a lot of those televangelists have been, I guess the term could be debunked, but they, you know, they're just scam artists.
Yeah.
I think people realize that by now. They're not as naive, I would hope, anyway. Otto is a really interesting... I don't know if he's necessarily an anti-hero. I mean, he starts out as kind of a dick.
He's a punk.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, but he's also like, I don't know, like a Holden Caulfield for the 80s, in a way, where he's real. And he's unfettered. he just says whatever is on his mind.
Yeah, I'm trying to think of any other, like, films of that time. Because he's supposed to be, what, a teenager or something?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Right, I'm trying to think of other teenage films. But this one is, like, there's something about his character. I mean, obviously, this film, punks obviously love this film for its punk attitude, you know.
Right.
But I think it also works for anybody, because there are, you know, people like Otto who just have this, like, you know, fuck the world, you know, fuck ordinary people, as he says, you know, I hate ordinary people, you know. Like, it's just kind of like, I'm not fitting in with the rest of, you know, society, and that's what you respond to, I think. So it's not simply for, really not just for punks, but it's for, you know, anybody, I think, like Otto, you know. They're out there, you know.
Oh, yeah. That anger, that, the frustration you feel with the rest of the world sort of seeps through the comic tone of the film, and the soundtrack complements everything in such a beautiful way. And even the guy that plays, I think his name is Kevin, his friend.
Oh yeah.
He went on to be one of the members of the Circle Jerks, which is kind of incredible.
Is he the nerd?
Yeah. he's the tall nerd at the beginning. The last person you'd expect to see in a punk band. But he went on to be in the Circle Jerks. I really love the introduction of Harry Dean Stanton in this, where he's just driving by and just decides, hey, this guy over here, let's I want to take him for a ride and show him the ropes. And the way he says, I got to get my wife's car out of this bad area.
Well, Harry Dean Stanton, I mean, he is just, I think it was Ebert might have said, like, if you see Harry Dean Stanton in the credits, you know it's going to be at least something good about the film.
Yeah.
Because he's always great.
He's just absolutely
fantastic, just character actors who is just, I don't know how to put it, but he's just so relaxed. I mean, he's one of those, you don't see him acting. You know, he's like Harvey Keitel. He doesn't seem to be acting, you know?
Yeah. That's that
very, yeah, he's
natural.
Yeah, and this is probably his, I mean, this is his, like, definitive role, I think, as the Repo Man.
Yeah, this in Paris, Texas, I think. It's funny that they came out in the same year and had the same cinematographer, where it's the perfect Harry Dean Stanton double feature, because you see the range that he's capable of. He does dark comedy beautifully. He does this restrained humanistic drama with Paris, Texas so beautifully. That, you know, it just goes to show that, you know, these character actors are sometimes better than the big names.
Oh, yeah.
So, yeah, but I'm curious, too, from your perspective, especially coming from a different country, watching this through American eyes, I guess you could say, there's just so many different things going on where I don't necessarily see it as an anti-conservative film, but it's certainly anti-Reagan, and it's fueled by, like I mentioned, the fear of Cold War at the time. I mean, obviously those are plot elements to some degree, but did you see this as like a countercultural statement in a way?
I do think I felt so first time I saw it. I was most of all taken by the spirit of the film and the unusual dialogue, and when I try to sell this film to some, you know, to get my friends to see this film, I tell them, like, look, imagine if something like a mix of like Tarantino and David Lynch is how I describe it for some
That's
people.
Good, you know? Yeah.
Yeah, it has that, like, Twin Peaks, you know, like that. Everybody's really weird, but they're natural at the same time. You know, like, some of the characters there, they have some of the most hysterical dialogue, and yet they, I mean, like, the part about John Wayne being gay, you know, which is just, it's just so odd conversations they have in the film, which is actually something that you see in many other Alex Cox films, you know. Very quirky, you know, it's a very quirky film, and I wasn't entirely sure what to make of it for some time. I mean, I loved it, but I was like, this whole thing with the car and the aliens and the whole with Repo Man, I mean, it was just like, this is like a whole new genre almost. a film. Like, I didn't know what to quite make of it, really.
You can't compare it to anything else.
Yeah, which to me kind of, I mean, I've tried to describe, like, compare Alex Cox to Tarantino in that they're both incredible film geeks. You know, I mean, it's famous their religion. They both love spaghetti westerns, deeply love them. But at the same time, of course, there are the similarities. I mean, Alex Cox, I don't think he's said anything really bad about Tarantino. But I read some book of his, and he like talks about, you know, using music from other films, and your film is bad and it's lazy, and you know. So I don't think he's somebody who is a fan of Tarantino. You know, definitely not. But there are definitely like that, you know, but he was like kind of Tarantino before Tarantino still, you know, like he was this brand new voice in the 80s, you know, like when people saw Repo Man, they obviously were like, wow, this is so refreshing to see, just completely new voice, you know? unhinged, you know.
His career kind of went in reverse in a way, because like later on he would be making a movie with a budget for like what $180,000 late in his career.
Which is
interesting.
Recently he's been just making like these micro feature films.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Like he made Repo Chick, which I looked at a trailer of, and it's basically just actors standing in front of green screens. And it's just like, I don't know.
It got horrible reviews.
Yeah.
I almost don't want to, I don't even want to expose myself to it because I'm afraid of ruining, you know, just the legacy of Repo Man.
Although
let that stand on its own.
Yes. I think Universal made some kind of Repo Man film called Repo Men with Jude Law.
Yeah, I don't think it's at all related
to
this universe. I don't think so.
Yeah. Yeah, Alex Cox has talked about that in some video interview, actually. He said that Universal basically, like, you know, wanted to sort of rip off, I think, Repo Man or something, or, you know, try to get people to see the film, you know, like... but that's, I think, is more of a science fiction thriller. Definitely not. Like, I don't think we're ever going to see a remake of Repo Man. It's just never going to happen.
I sure hope the hell not. That'd be too... Ugh. No, don't.
And I know,
dear Hollywood, don't remake this one, please.
No, and I think he's talked about trying to make some Repo Man sequel. I think he said, I don't know, but... As far as his later career goes, I mean, he has a film in the can, I think, right now. I don't know if it's finished or not, but it started as a Kickstarter thing.
Oh, okay. Yeah, that's all the rage these days. Yeah,
which I contributed to because I like Alex Cox. So it's called Tombstone Rashomon. Have you read about this?
Oh, no. That's interesting.
Yeah, it's...
Let me look.
Since it's supposed to be a, you know, of course, the story of, you know, White Earp. Quite a few films about him. And this is going to be about White Earp. It's going to be about the OK Corral shootout.
But it's okay.
But it's going to be told in the style of the Kurosawa film, Rashomon. So we're going to see different perspectives, which, you know, it could be interesting, you know, see what... And of course, being a Western,
You know, the thing I kind of really dig is the monologue that Miller has. He's kind of a quirky philosopher. And, you know, he stresses, like, this idea of a cosmic unconsciousness, and it brings up the lattice of coincidence that hangs over the world with that plate of shrimp idea. That whole thing is really... really interesting to me, which, you know, it could simply be Alex Cox spouting his own ideas of the universe through a character, which he does rather frequently in something like Walker. But, you know, I think doing things like that sort of endear me a lot, where it's the kind of stuff that Richard Linklater does very, very well, where a character will just be having a conversation that you have with your friends, or when you're thinking deep thoughts, or you're high, you know, with all your friends, and just hanging out.
And he's, of course, a fan of Alex Cox. I know that. He's a fan of...
Oh, yeah. I can tell. And Three Businessmen felt like a Richard Linklater Before Sunrise kind of movie, only with two dudes.
But the way what you said about that scene where he's talking about the time machines and saucers, I think you're referring to, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. You said it was like, it was like a conversation you would have, and it's just a conversation scene, you know, two characters. And to me, Repo Man is, and I think it might have been Tarantino who actually said this. Like, Tarantino has, I think, has talked about, like, movies you call, like...
Hangout movies.
Hangout movies, that's right.
Yeah.
And this is one of those, I think. This is
perfect.
Yeah. There's, like, maybe not... I don't know. I could be wrong with this. But there might not be a straight, like, three-act structure to the film, you know, like, you know, like, typical... But it's just a great hangout film. Like, oh, yeah, like, you just want to watch the film just to hang out with these characters.
Really. Yeah. I always look forward to seeing Bud... and Otto together hanging out. That's I love everything about this movie, but their chemistry, their relationship together, just like, you know, two guys on a diet of beer and cocaine, taking joyrides, going after rival repo men, and just doing what they do kind of haphazardly at times is just constantly entertaining. I mean, as much as like Alex Cox sort of embraces the social commentary element and embracing punk subculture and everything, it really is just a good old-fashioned dark comedy of sorts.
I know a life of crime led me to this sorry fate. I blame society. Society made me what I am.
That's bullshit. You're a white suburban punk, just like me.
It feels like a mashup of a lot of different things and a lot of different elements, but somehow it feels like it's completely original at the same time.
This is one of those it's one of those cult classics of the 80s. It's up there with, you know, Big Trouble in Little China, or
I thought of They Live too, a little bit.
There's a kind of a They Live feel to it. And also that movie, what's it called with Peter Weller? Is it called Buckaroo Banzai?
Oh yeah, yeah, totally.
Just this completely crazy like 80s films where like, whoa, what is going on here, you know?
Yeah.
But Repo Man managed to like some ways maybe take itself even more like become almost like a real film compared to those. Like, you know what I mean? Like it almost like has like this something to say and all these, unlike those other films, you know. Well, not live, but you know what I mean? Like it's not just simply goofy fun. It's also like, you know, wants to be about, you know, this something.
Yeah, it has the floating green glowing car at the very end, combined with something grounded, like the scene where he's talking with his parents. I mean, we were all teenagers who had these moments of complete disconnect from whatever our parents were into. With me and my dad, it was, I would come home from school or from my crappy job at a fast food restaurant to see my dad watching NASCAR racing. And I was just like, I can't get into that at all. And, you know, he'd just be kind of like zoned out, relaxing on the couch, watching this stuff. And I'd just be like, I'm going to go upstairs and watch movies. Bye.
And my parents were separated. My father definitely tried to get me into like hockey. And I just could not get into that. And
sure.
My mother, you know, she didn't exactly like my movie choices. She actually thought I would become a serial killer because I watched horror films.
I think all moms have that fear. My mom was definitely concerned when I was watching like Nightmare on Elm Street and Evil Dead.
Yeah, and she would often be like talk about how I dress and how I look and say, why can't you be normal? Basically, like, this is how people like I don't care. You know, like I don't care how people.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I know what you mean. I know what you mean. Yeah.
That's kind of why I sort of mentioned the Holden Caulfield for the 80s kind of feel I get to Otto's character, where it's just like, you know, damn the man, I'm going to do whatever I want. And even at the very end, what about our relationship?
Fuck that.
Oh, that's so great. Everything about this movie just rules. Like, I watch it every time and I love it all the more. It's creeping up on my list of favorite movies of all time. Like, the more I watch it, the more I consider it. Like, this is my kind of movie, through and through.
Yeah, yeah. And I just wonder, like, would you call it a comedy? Or what exactly would you, how would you, like, I think we talked.
I guess satire. I mean, like, satire. That's the first thing I think of, and maybe, you know, doing a little research, or I feel like that's kind of what people lean towards. You know, it's a punk rock satire of some kind. You know, it's its own thing.
Yeah, and many of Alex Cox's films have that satire feel to it, with maybe the exception of Highway Patrolman, which it might be his most serious film.
I would say that, and I also think, I mean, there's a moment where Pedro hurls a bottle of tequila at George Bush on TV, if I recall.
There was a scene like that. He froze at some politician who was talking about Mexico.
Yeah, I think it was George Bush. So,
which is very relevant.
He had to sneak it in there somehow.
Yeah, Alex Cox, he's very interested in Mexico and, you know, Central America.
Yeah, he lived there for a while, I think.
Oh, yeah. Oh, he did. Yeah, that might explain. I mean, he's so fascinated by those countries, to the point where, of course, he wants to make movies about them and really address the political issues there.
Yeah, I know he's a film teacher, but he clearly reads a lot, and he's interested in sociology and politics.
Yeah, and I was there's this 30-minute video on YouTube. It's him and the writer, Rudy, what's his name? But he wrote
Rolitzer.
Yeah, who wrote Walker. Yeah, they're talking about Walker. And at some point, Alex Cox is like, wants to recommend this 9/11 documentary to everybody, which is basically about, I think, like the fact that 9/11 was an inside job or something.
Yeah, I've heard that. I've heard that too. Mm. I remember a friend of mine showing me something, and I was skeptical about it.
Yeah.
But at the same time, we don't want to get into conspiracy theories here.
No. But that's Alex Cox.
The end. Probably his most critically acclaimed of his filmography, and that's Sid and Nancy, which I also saw. I'm pretty sure I rented this too around the same time as Repo Man, without realizing they were the same director at all. But you know, clearly, he loves punk rock.
Yeah, I think I heard about this film from somebody when I was working at a dog daycare here in Sweden. One of the girls who's really this kind of like really into heavy metal and stuff, you know, really gothic girl. And she was just like, oh, I love this movie, Sid and Nancy. And so I decided to buy the film for her.
And then she adopted two puppies and named them Sid and Nancy.
No. But when I looked at the DVD, I was like, oh, directed by Alex Cox, the Repo Man guy. So, yeah. And I watched it and this is actually, you know, of all his films, he regards this as his least favorite, actually.
It's his most conventional, quote-unquote, you know?
But also he doesn't like it because he doesn't think it's true. Like, he doesn't think it's truthful enough to the actual Sid and Nancy and, I think, Sex Pistols. I think that's where he's like...
I wonder if he genuinely feels that way or if it's just a little bit of backlash from the punk scene and people who knew the real Sid and Nancy. Like, I think even said he kind of downplays things.
I know that when he was... Actually, at the same time he was doing Repo Man, he had already met, again, the writer Walker, and they were planning to do Walker, but instead he had to do Sid and Nancy first or something. So he was... I guess it was like kind of a work-for-hire in some ways. Like, I think it was. And then he was like, okay, punk, Sid and Nancy, I can maybe make a... I can deal with this, maybe.
Yeah, I don't think it's a passion project, but he certainly brings his own sense of style to it and his love of the scene, clearly. Yeah.
Oh, yeah. And there's that maniacal energy to the film, which you will see in this later.
Yeah.
Hell.
It's very manic. And it has this, like...
Which is funny because when you watch Alex Cox in interviews or listen to his audio commentaries, he's very gentle, very soft-spoken. You don't really think he's somebody who's into, you know, punk rock or somebody who would make these kinds of films.
Yeah, he seems pretty chill. He seems pretty laid back, and I kind of appreciate that more than the arms flailing, speaking really fast
Tarantino.
Quality of Tarantino. Yeah.
Mm. Yeah,
but I think it's a compelling love story, but I take away from it, like Trainspotting or Requiem for a Dream, it's a cautionary tale. Nobody should ever go near heroin. It's all fun and games and feeling numb until you accidentally stab your girlfriend, you know? And, like, that sentiment has definitely been done in other films. There's been many films about drug abuse.
Mm.
But I think this one manages to combine, you know, the love of punk music, a love story, and a cautionary tale about drug abuse all together beautifully. That it's kind of a special film, especially for the performances.
Yeah, it is. It's a film I would definitely recommend for people. Is it, I mean, especially if you're a Gary Oldman fan.
Oh, Gary good Oldman God.
He is just off his rockers in this film. And this is like one of his, I think, very first roles. I think he might have been his first film. I'm not sure. I could be wrong about that. But it was definitely like his, must have been his first like major starring role. And he's just, I mean, he is that Sid Vicious. I'm not a fan of Sid Vicious or whatever, but seeing him in this film, I go, that is a punk.
Yeah, no, he
on heroin.
It just seems like he went all out in almost a method kind of way. I don't know. Obviously, he's not really shooting heroin, but
yeah, I think probably at that. I mean, Gary Oldman, he is a very, very capable actor. I think at that point, he was definitely probably very method, and probably Chloe Webb as well. You know, they're probably living, you know, those roles. They're probably. Probably weren't even taking off those clothes, you know. We were, you know.
Yeah, I've read that too. That they never change their clothes, so there's just this constant smell of puke and BO and or whatever.
Yeah, that's the way to make a film, isn't it? I mean, I read about like The Deer Hunter and how Robert De Niro like really wanted to live in that small town, and like one of the actors in that film, The Deer Hunter, like. He's not even an actor. He's just one of the. He just Robert De Niro met this guy in the pub. Was like, "Hey, you want to be in the film in our movie?"
I think this has its place. I think that sort of approach, like the Sean Penn, the Gary Oldman, the Val Kilmer approach, has its place in mm-hmm. terms of getting amazing performances. But yeah, then you go to extremes.
Well,
like
of course,
Dustin
as long as
Hoffman.
As long as it doesn't like you know hurt anybody,
right? You know, mental, but physical. That's what I'm saying. It's like Dustin Hoffman. He wanted. For Marathon Man of all movies, he wanted to know what it was like to have dental work done without any anesthetic, without any Novocaine. So he went to a dentist to just say, like, can you work on my teeth, even though there was nothing wrong with it?
Well, that is very strange. That is odd.
Yeah, and then, of course, Laurence Olivier, his response to that, to Dustin Hoffman, was there's this thing called acting, Dustin, you should give it a try.
Well, yeah, I've heard about that, but isn't that kind of like a myth or something?
I don't know if it. I thought that was. I read that somewhere, but maybe it is a myth.
Orson Welles
debunked it.
Orson Welles said it best when it comes to acting. It's when Oliver Reed met Orson Welles, and they made a film together actually. And Oliver Reed was like, "Well, how do you do it? What do you do when? How do you act?" And Orson Welles' response was, "You do nothing." You do nothing, my dear boy. And, you know, you're like, wait, what? But then you're like, oh, yeah, you know, like, there really isn't that much. Like, don't think about it. Just do it. You know, just do it. Don't think about how you should do it. Just act. Just know your lines and interact with the other actor and just do it. That's it, really. I think that's what he was saying.
I think the thing I like a lot about Sid and Nancy is that it doesn't spend a whole lot of time placing its characters in, like, this cultural context where it establishes this is this time period. Like stuff like Seabiscuit, Cinderella Man, or even Ray, they're just, you know, like this is the time and let's flash back to this and let's do this. And it sort of really hits the nail over the head. It like plays down to the audience. And here, it's just like, let's throw you into this world right away. Yeah. There's a beautiful sequence where it's that, man, that disastrous Silver Jubilee celebration where Sid and Nancy walk through the police mayhem like ghosts. Alex Cox is really good at these long tracking shots through chaos. Like, there's a moment in Walker where Ed Harris is just walking, Highway Patrolman.
Mm.
Those shots are what really stand out to me, is that it's not flashy and necessarily, it's just I'm letting the camera follow this character in this really intense moment, and you feel it. You feel like you're there with them in this chaos.
Yeah, again, unlike Tarantino, he's not a flashy filmmaker at all. In many ways, I think he probably wants to make his films as less flashy as possible. There is quite a bit of... I mean, occasionally he will do something like he'll use slow motion. There's a beautiful slow motion shot in this film where he walks through the glass door.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
It's just an amazing little moment. He's, of course, a fan of Sam Peckinpah.
Clearly.
Very evident in his later films, like Walker. He's one of those directors. I think the thing about Alex Cox, and somebody once said about Tarantino that he's somebody who makes art pranks. His movies are like art pranks. You know what I mean by that?
Yeah, I could see that.
Yeah, like, for example, like The Hateful Eight is like this, it's going to be shot in 70 millimeters, it's going to be this big epic Western, and it's all shot in a little cabin. You know, like, it's just...
Well, I think he... I don't know if he's just trying to fuck with people or subverting their expectations like that.
But he's a fan of Godard. I know he's a fan of Godard.
Sure.
And somebody like Alex Cox, it's probably a similar thing. I think he's... Another thing also is about these two guys, like Cox and Tarantino, is like there's so much knowledge about film. They know every single way to make a film. That they're probably just kind of like, all right, I'm going to do it my own way, you know?
But it's also... I think some of it's embedded into their subconscious to where... I don't know if they're explicitly saying, I'm going to rip this thing off or I'm going to pay homage to this thing. Maybe Tarantino does that, but I think a lot of directors sort of, they love movies. They watch them over and over and over again. I think they're just inevitably going to mirror the style of films that they love.
Sure. And Alex Cox, he's also a fan of, he speaks a lot about Louis Buñuel.
Yeah, that's a director I need to explore more of for sure, because a lot of people...
Yeah, me too. I need to explore his work.
Yeah, he's kind of a blind spot for me, and I've been meaning to finally see, like, the discrete genre, the bourgeois and all those films. There's
Belle de Jour.
I've seen Belle de Jour, and that's a really great film.
I got, like, The Experimenting Angel on DVD. That's actually the name of, I think, Alex Cox production company.
Yeah, totally.
Yeah.
So it's funny, I mentioned the cinematographer of Repo Man, but this time...
Roger Deakins.
Yeah, right?
Wow.
That guy...
He's gone places.
Uh-huh, I'll say. With the Coen brothers, nonetheless.
Yeah, you know, Alex Cox's first, I would say, four films, they're pretty much shot like traditional films, but and they're all, I think, exceptionally well-made films. But when you get to his later films in the 90s, he starts to get into this, like, I'm going to do everything in one take thing.
Yeah.
Which I have mixed feelings on. Let me get there. But Sid and Nancy is a... It's just to my last words on it. It is a brutal but beautiful love story. That's what I'd say. It's tragic. Tragic.
Yeah, you know, it's not necessarily a film that you can sort of deconstruct in the way we can for something like Repo Man or Walker, where it really is a straightforward portrayal of self-destructive love. When he sort of illustrates their complete detachment from reality when they light the floor of the Chelsea Hotel on fire.
Yeah, and also Chloe Webb, she kind of disappeared.
Yeah. I really hadn't seen her in anything else, I don't think.
When I looked her up, I saw that, she's in Ghostbusters 2.
Oh, okay.
She's at the beginning. She's somebody who talks about, I think, being, like, taken by aliens or something. But, yeah, but she is not... Oh, yeah, that's right. She was in The Belly of an Architect, the Peter Greenaway film. But she's not your traditional, like, striking, beautiful, love interest. Like, I see so many comments from people saying, like, oh, she's so ugly and But that's what I like about her. This is, you know, like, reality to her. She's not glamorous.
Yeah, she's not your traditional starlet.
Yeah.
You know, and that's something that, obviously, I think they intentionally... casted her for, and I know originally Courtney Love was going to play the role, or at least she auditioned for it.
And you know who else was up for the role of Sid Vicious?
When you tell me, I'll know or I'll remember.
Daniel Day-Lewis.
That's right, yes. Which would totally be awesome.
That would have been awesome. I've seen him in some 80s film. I can't remember what it's called. Laundry or something, I think. But
My Beautiful Laundrette?
That's it. Yeah, that's it. That's the one.
Yeah.
So yeah, I can definitely see him in that role. That would have been
cool. Of course. Talk about method. That's a guy who just, again, goes for broke.
I don't think he played this kind of role back then, did he?
I don't think so, no.
But it would have been like him playing like the role in Gangs of New York, or it would have been the same kind of intense.
I like showy Daniel Day-Lewis roles. When it comes to acting, I do like the less is more naturalistic approach. But when it comes to Daniel Day-Lewis, yeah, chew that scenery. I don't care. I'm all for it.
He's very methody too, isn't he? Like, he's totally into it. Yeah.
I drink your milkshake.
But let's get to the next couple of films here.
I can talk. You didn't finish Straight to Hell. You saw like 20 minutes of it.
Yeah, I sense it was like a kind of a Django spaghetti homage with the setup of strangers crashing into a small town. But the tone was very acerbic. When you have like Courtney Love screaming at the top of her lungs, I can't deal with it.
Yeah, it's that film. It's first time I saw it, I didn't quite like it. I was like, what is this? This is so overbearing. It just goes on and on and on to no real like good end. And it was supposed to be this spoof of spaghetti westerns. That's what it was supposed to be. And there's certainly, I mean, of all, compared to his other films, it is very, I mean, it's so crazy. It's so over the top, perhaps more so than his other films. I mean, like, it's not serious at all. All I can say about this film is it has some really funny moments to it. It's got some great moments to it.
Sure, I bet.
And if you want to see Jim Jarmusch as a gangster or something, he's in the film.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, he's in the shootout at the end. He's got this white suit on and everything. So, yeah, Jim Jarmusch.
You know, I've often said this on the show, too. It's a director always wants to make a Hitchcock kind of film. But I think this is very true, especially with some recent directors. I think directors want to make their own Western. You know? I mean, Jim Jarmusch, clearly, with Dead Man.
Yeah, John Carpenter definitely, but never got to.
Yeah, that's all he wanted to make. He always wanted to remake Rio Bravo in different settings. But yeah, no, it definitely felt like, well, this is a straight on sort of gangster western from Alex Cox, and I don't know, I might finish at some point, but it was just, I don't know, the tone was really.
Yeah, he released a director's cut or something a couple of years ago. It was called Straight to Hell Returns, and he added, like, I haven't watched it. He added, like, digital blood or something to it, and he cut it down. It sounds weird, but I need to check it out. But it was funny. I was going to watch the commentary track, but I didn't get to finish it. I watched a little bit of it, and it was kind of funny because the writer was on there, and they get to the scene where he just kind of goes, well, that scene was a waste of time, wasn't it? Alex is very open about it, like, what was that about? What did he shoot the bed for?
Like, oh, wow.
Yeah, but Alex Cox's like, oh, no, dude. And he starts to explain, like, the reason for it.
That's similar to the commentary for The Limey.
Yeah, but like I said, there is something about Straight to Hell. It's got that weird, crazy energy to it. It's got some funny lines. There's some moments that I think are just kind of funny, like when Courtney Love is walking around this western town, and this little figure comes out and goes, "Psst, psst, hey, psst." He goes, "Wow, what do you want?" And he kind of goes and starts talking to her, and then like she proceeds to walk away, and then he goes, "Psst, psst, come here," and she goes, "No, get away from me, get away from me." And this guy starts chasing her. He goes,
"No, get away from me, get away from me."
Yeah, that's this sort of British sensibility, you know, like almost like the Monty Python sense of humor.
I was just gonna say that, Monty Python.
Yeah, this was like written in 3 days, shot in 3 weeks. I think he just sort of did it because he wasn't able to do. I think he wanted to follow I don't know if it was Joe Strummer, or I can't remember what band it was. I don't think it was The Clash. But he wanted to basically do, like, a rockumentary. And then he couldn't get funding for it. So his producer was just like, why don't we just do a little throwaway kind of Western in the same environment? Because, you know, he was really fascinated with this landscape in Mexico and stuff.
Hmm. Yeah, it is. And I mean, yeah, Courtney Love, I mean, she gets on your nerves, doesn't she? I mean, she is so, so, I mean, and but also she's interesting because she's so, like, I mean, I'm not somebody who keeps up on, like, what Courtney Cox looks like, but she's, like, kind of chubby in the movie. She's very, like, badly dressed and just, there's something about her in this film. I think that the funny thing is they try to interview her for the DVD, but she wouldn't do it. She wouldn't come back and talk about it. And Alex Cox actually got an actress then to pretend to be Courtney Love, which was not supposed to be like a secret. Like, he was very expressive. Oh yeah, I got somebody to play Courtney Cox for an interview. So,
you know, you're combining Courtney Love with Alex Cox.
Oh, sorry. Oh
no, that's actually kind of funny.
Did I say Courtney Cox?
Yeah.
That would be something. That would be something, right? Courtney Cox and
yeah, I could see Courtney Love and Scream because she screams so much.
No, get away from me! Get away.
Yeah, pretty much. That's like, I like her as a front woman for a rock band because she just has that attitude for it.
Sure. What movies has she done? She was in
People vs. Larry Flint is where she got a lot of acclaim, maybe even a Golden Globe nomination. But she was just playing herself,
right? Really.
So yeah, I mean, it's an interesting transition from Straight to Hell to Walker because he used the same crew and managed to get some good funding from a capitalist studio, essentially, which is really because this is a movie that's condemning capitalism, essentially.
Oh yeah,
you know, so it's just kind of ironic.
It's kind of condemning the U.S., isn't it?
Yes.
I don't know how this movie got made.
I don't either.
It's one of those, wait, how did it get... It's like Ken Russell's The Devil. It's like, wait, how did this movie get made?
Yeah, what if Pasolini and Monty Hellman and Sam Peckinpah made a film about how much they hated the sort of Iran-Contra involvement at the time and sort of goes back to find a parallel between what Reagan was doing at the time and what William Walker was doing in 1855. So it's really very critical of American foreign policy and just how we tend to intervene and stick our noses in where they don't belong. You know, this goes further back, I'm sure. But, you know, Vietnam being the prime example.
Oh, yeah, we get a little thing at the end, in the end credits, of course, where we see, like, footage from, like, Vietnam. They talk about Vietnam, that Reagan is on TV, and talking about Vietnam and soldiers, you know. And
yeah, we'll get to kind of the ending sort of surprise in a bit.
I must say, I didn't really know anything about Nicaragua before I saw this film. Like, this was something I'm not really... I didn't know who the hell William Walker was. But this film just felt to me, it felt so relevant still to this day. Like, yeah, U.S. invading another country and promising, we're going to do this, but then they just take it over, you know.
Yeah.
Just goes to war. It's just, wow. So relevant. Still, it's probably going to continue to be relevant through years to come. You know,
Oh, I would completely agree because, I mean, even at one point, a character says, you know, like something along the lines of Republican, Democrat, I can't tell the difference.
Yeah.
And that is really what's happening in our country right now with Trump and Clinton. Like, people are just they don't know what to think and say at this point. It's shocking to even realize that Trump has gotten as far as he has. It really is.
Yeah, it's kind of scary
and sad. I just can't get over this. But anyway, back to the movie. This movie is all over the place, but that is kind of its charm. I've said this a lot too, where I think a lot of movies, when they throw all these different things into a blender, it comes across to me as like what Southland Tales was for Richard Kelly, where it's just like, I got this idea, this social commentary, this political commentary. You know, he was very critical of something like the Patriot Act in that movie. But he also wanted to have his cake and eat it too, and just sort of be playful, embed his story into a science fiction Philip K. Dick universe. So, like, here, it's I would say, like, at least in terms of setting, it's consistent. But there is a weird, surreal playfulness through very serious subject matter. Like, there's a comedic reverence, almost, with the way Ed Harris portrays Walker.
I'm a disgrace! This whole operation is a fucking disgrace, your worship! You are stripped of your rank.
You can either stay here as a private or you can leave.
A private this, Willie! Holy shit! Hey!
Yeah, all the anachronisms.
Yeah.
Which is just, first time you see it, you're like, wait a second, what's happening? It's a car?
Yeah, why are there Coke bottles all of a sudden?
Yeah, and they're reading, like, what is it called? The magazine, the news, something. I can't remember what it was called.
Oh, right, yeah.
And, like, Walker's like, have you seen this? and like, the helicopter at the end. I wonder, like, with this film, if he had, I'm not sure, did he have Final Cut on this film? I wonder if the whole, like, voiceover narration and some of the weird, like, sudden, like, oh, and this happens, and then this happened. I wonder if maybe there was some stuff that was cut out of the film or something.
It feels, I don't want to say incomplete or like poorly edited or rushed job or anything like that. But a story like this, I wouldn't necessarily think it should be condensed to 90 minutes. I mean, yeah, I think the pacing is a little off here and there through this movie.
Mm-hmm.
But there's just some, again, that go for broke nature really sits well with me when you just sort of throw caution to the wind, get very angry about the way Americans intervene with a sort of cowboy mentality and sense of entitlement. Clearly, Cox is pissed off about American politics in general. In the same way that maybe Kubrick did with Dr. Strangelove, you know, it's a critique. It's a satire. I mean, obviously, Dr. Strangelove is a much funnier film with a more consistent tone. But I think people that didn't click with Walker initially, I think they took it too seriously.
Well, yeah, they thought Alex Cox was on, Walker's side.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, he is the protagonist, but he's the bad guy, definitely.
Exactly.
He's demented in the film. I mean, at the beginning of the film, he goes, you know, I'm against slavery. And then at some point in the film, he goes, let's introduce slavery into Nicaragua. Because he's so been driven off the edge by that point. You know, he so believes that he's destined for greatness, you know.
But I can see people being put off by, like, at times he's like a cartoon character, and at other times he's, you know, openly weeping over the death of his fiance.
I think Ed Harris is amazing in this film.
It's an incredible performance.
She's with God now, my son.
Don't talk to me about God! What do you know about God? Get out!
I can't. And don't! Oh, you bitch!
It's very much a classic Ed Harris performance in that he is so intense, it looks like he's going to attack the cameraman at any point. You know, the actual guy who is filming, you know?
Yeah.
Like you don't want to disturb this guy because he is into it. I think this might have been Ed Harris' like first major... I know he was in Knight Riders before that.
I think he was in The Right Stuff, too.
Right, and he was in Under Fire. That's right. He did some movies that... But this was like his first major, I think, starring role. So, and he just goes for it. I mean, he is so... Apparently, and I think I heard that he was really into the part. Like, he was just always into that mindset as the character.
I can tell. He's really good in this. I mean, the only thing is, it's hard to get a good read on does Walker really believe his own BS. It's like he's speechifying about democracy at one point, and then, you know, he's performing surgery and eating someone's heart and then smiling.
Yeah, that's right. He does that. I was wondering what that was. I was like, wait, did he just eat some kind of part of his body? What was that?
I mean, again, I think that's Alex Cox's sense of humor being very Monty Python-esque.
Mm.
You know, just sort of throwing something like that in. But I think what turned people off is that this is a serious issue, you know, going on, especially at the time with Reagan's infiltration and just the idea of like, well, let's go in and help, but essentially we want to take over.
Mm.
And here, like, Cox is sort of taking the piss and just viewing it through like this lens of ridiculousness. Like, just look at how ridiculous those Americans are thinking they can do this. And I think that's a good approach, honestly. Like, you don't have to take everything so seriously. You don't have to treat this like Dances with Wolves or, you know, just a serious tone.
Yeah.
Like Clint Eastwood would do.
Yeah. I mean, when I was going through Alice Cox's biography and I came to this film, I was like, okay, what is this supposed to be? Some sort of biopic or, you know? And
it
I watched
like it. Yeah.
And it's like, whoa, no, what is this? This is something completely different. This is not your typical... I mean, it's been described as a hallucinatory biopic, as a surrealistic take on William Walker, and it is definitely... I mean, it breaks so many cinematic conventions.
Yeah, it's remarkably subversive.
Yeah, and the way he wants to, you know, parallel what's happening with Anna... You know, Chrisms, you know, with the helicopter at the end showing up, which is so, I mean, I wonder what people thought of that when they saw it in the film.
That actually made me want to applaud in the same way that the frogs falling out of the sky in Magnolia makes me want to applaud. Because that's a ballsy choice to just suddenly, okay, let's throw in a helicopter storming in, almost like storming in on the production of the movie.
Yeah, I was wondering about that. Like, you almost think that, well, wait, whoa, it's the producers coming to stop.
It's, again, it's almost like the ending of Holy Grail, you know, where it's just...
It is very Monty Python, isn't it?
By exploiting the workers, by hanging on to outdated imperialist dogma which perpetuates the economic and social differences in our society. If there's ever going to be any progress...
Daddy, there's some lovely filth down here!
I'm Arthur, King of the Britons. Whose castle is that?
King of the who?
The Britons.
Who are the Britons?
I dig that shit, man. I just think it's... I think it's hilarious. I think, you know, the fact that characters are drinking Coca-Cola, reading Newsweek, and... I don't know, man. That's... And... Like the sort of lively salsa music while these grisly blood squibs are exploding, you know? And don't they literally come across Sam Peckinpah's grave or something at one point?
Oh, I didn't see that. But there are shots that are like, it's not like somebody falling off a balcony in slow motion, and that's very Sam Peckinpah.
Absolutely. And maybe it is just because I recently did a Peckinpah episode and we talked about Pat Garrett and Billy the Kid and Bring Me the Head of Alfredo Garcia, that I was sort of in the mindset of this could be kind of a weird allegory / homage, and that's totally fine.
Yeah, it's written by Rudy Wurlitzer, who wrote Pat Garrett and Billy the Kid.
Yeah. So I just found that out after watching it. I was just like, oh, that totally makes sense.
Yeah, and Alex Cox said that he's like the only real like writer who's like dealt with the politics of the Western in America anyway. So
the big criticism for me is that Peter Boyle plays it way too big, and there's no need to have a fart joke.
You fucked up, Walker. Next time, pick on a country your own size.
Are you entitled to wear that uniform?
I'm entitled to do anything I want.
You know, people probably fart in real life. They probably do like that. They just
all you have to do is see Swiss Army Man to know have a nice parable about farts.
Yeah, it's to show, like, you know, I can do whatever I want. Basically.
That's true. I know I'm sure a character like Vanderbilt owning a giant railroad company, he probably was a total dick and played things big in real life. I don't doubt that. I'm just kind of like that, like when he takes the flowers and starts, and he just starts like hitting people with them. I don't know. I just found it. I mean, there are many silly things going on in this movie, but that felt like almost Zucker Brothers silly all of a sudden. But so the ending of this, when the helicopter shows up and sort of gives us like a modern feel, all of a sudden, and then
coming to pick up the Americans, you know, not any. Very, yeah.
And then in the way that the movie ends kind of reminds me a little bit of the sense of humor, the preachiness of what Lars von Trier does at the end of Dogville. Probably the best movie that criticizes America in general would be Dogville, in my opinion. But this comes pretty close.
But this is maybe a
scathing satire.
The fact also this was released by a major studio in Hollywood.
Exactly.
That makes this even, I think. I mean, and how this got released, I know they tried to bury it. You know, like, Alex Cox tried to get the film out in, like, film festivals, but they just buried it. Like, they made some deal with some film festival, like, no, we don't take Walker, take this other film instead. You know, they really tried to bury it.
Yeah. It really showcases, again, American interventionism at its most, like, totalitarian, but it also makes fun of it. Just, like, the fact that we even do this kind of stuff is ridiculous in the eyes of Alex Cox. So I think this tone is appropriate for the material. Not everybody's going to click with it because we don't, you know, they may not just find it funny.
Mm. It is kind of that, again, going to Tarantino, there is that, like, kind of like Inglourious Basterds, you know.
Yeah.
Let's just kind of make fun of how, you know, let's just go.
Let's make fun of Hitler.
Yeah. Let's just go crazy, you know, because it's so absurd looking back on it.
Which I'm totally fine with. I like to laugh at everything. You know, even when my dad was diagnosed with cancer, we made jokes. Because that's how people deal with it sometimes when you're dealing with heavy shit. So it helps. I mean, humor is every bit as therapeutic as composing music or watching films or reading a great book or going to actual therapy. So yeah, I think it's appropriate.
Yeah, comedians, they are kind of like really the darkest people you can talk to, aren't they? Like they're the ones who really know how they feel. They probably are the probably most depressed people, but their way to deal with that is through comedy, you know.
Yeah, someone like Robin Williams really had a dark side that he sort of dealt with through comedy.
Mm.
But, what do you think of Joe Strummer's score in Walker?
Oh, it's like many of other Alex Cox films. Like, it's a really cool score.
Yeah, it's so different. It's not at all what I was expecting for this kind of film.
Mm, he has a great taste for music, Alex Cox, when it comes to his films. And one of his films, he actually ended up being recut. They actually replaced the music, and he was very upset by that, actually, in one of his later films. So, yeah. Walker is just like, people gotta check it out if they haven't seen it. It's
it's weird because it was released on Criterion, but it's kind of like buried at the same time. It's not one that's like as readily available. I think the Criterion released in like 2008 or something, but I didn't even know that until I looked it up and was like, oh, wow, I can get this on Criterion. That's pretty cool. Mm.
Yeah, I mean, it's kind of, I think it's maybe having kind of a resurgence. I mean, there was this screening of the film a couple of years ago, but I don't know what's happening with it. I mean, Alex Cox is frankly kind of a forgotten filmmaker. You know, he's not had like a big career resurgence like, let's say, William Friedkin, who's so beloved by people, you know.
Yeah. Yeah, no, that's true. Like, Friedkin even just, I mean, I don't think Bug was as huge of a mainstream success, but that to me felt like the return of Friedkin with Bug. And now with Killer Joe, I think he's officially back in action, so I hope he makes some more good films.
Oh, have you seen the taglines for Walker on IMDb?
Something about Rambo, right?
Yeah, it was on the poster. It says, before Rambo, before Oliver North. Wow. What are they trying to sell here?
Yeah. Well, that's the thing, too, is like, I think Ebert and a critic by the name of Michael Wilmington were really put off by the idea of, like, almost like a Rambo approach to the graphic violence. You know, the blood squibs, just the graphic nature of it was really off-putting to them in the midst of this humor. Like, again, it is kind of a mishmash of tones, but it's still really clever.
Yeah, I mean, that's what I feel about many of Alex Cox's films. I mean, there is this mismatch of tone. You're kind of going, you know, what is this?
Yeah, but I love that experience. I love going, what is this?
Yeah.
And, I mean, how many fucking trailers do you see at the theater where you go, oh, I know where this movie is going. Oh, I can see how this is going to play out. Oh, you know, like the romantic comedy or the London is Falling.
I mean, that's
disaster.
I mean, of course, that's the problem with Hollywood, because if you try to make a film in Hollywood, you have to pitch, you know, your story, and they have to, you know, they go, well, what is this? Is it a comedy or is it, you know? And you might say, well, it's a horror comedy, and they go, ah, can we market that? You know, like, they don't like that stuff. They don't like it when you go, you know, into make a film that's just different from anything else out there. They need to know if they can market it. And somebody like Alex Cox, you know, he's never going to make another studio film.
Never. You know what? I think people, especially in light of the success of Breaking Bad and how that was just like a universally beloved show, I think if Highway Patrolman were to come out now, especially after the fact that something like No Country for Old Men won Best Picture, I think this would have a nice following. I wouldn't say it would be huge. It's definitely a conventional film, but Highway Patrolman is, you know, it's sort of him going back to his roots in a way, but it's also him finding a nice middle ground between like a conventional narrative / character arc with genre and his own sensibilities, I think.
Yeah, I told you that this was his favorite film of his, actually.
It's very simple.
Yeah, and also he did say that he felt Walker was his best work, but this is his favorite, just personal favorite.
Interesting.
And when I watched it, I mean, I knew who Alex Cox was, but I was expecting some kind of crazy satire like his other films. But it's so much more serious and dramatic than his earlier films. It doesn't go into that parody or comical character, from what I remember. It's the film. It takes its subject matter very seriously.
Yeah, when something bad happens, you're not laughing. You know, like when his car breaks down, even though you know it's a piece of shit.
Yeah, and his friend dies. You know, that's...
God, that is... I gotta say, I thought... There's a sequence about an hour into this that had me on the edge of my seat. When you know how things are gonna play out, but a lot of it is playing out through the police scanner, you know, the radio in the car. And I just thought this was impeccably well done, and one of the highlights of his filmography was just this chase sequence where the car breaks down and he has to literally run to try and save his friend, and you just don't know what's going to happen when he finally gets there. And it takes this time. Like, he employs what you would call these really moving master single takes, where it's there's hardly any cuts, if any at all, at that moment where the car breaks down and he's running after having, you know, his basically his leg severely injured.
That's what that struck me the first time I saw it. It was like, whoa, what's going on here? I'm not seeing any cuts. It's all happening in one single take. And it's like he's experimenting with something here. Trying out, I guess, like, what if I don't do the reversing? You know, what if I just shoot everything in one take? And that's kind of, I think that was kind of, that was very unusual at the time. Because nowadays, of course, you know, with, you know, Birdman and The Revenant, but back in those days, I don't think anybody did that.
So no, I don't think. I mean, obviously, a lot of European cinema. a lot of European cinema definitely did that kind of approach. Like, it's very neorealism to just sort of let a scene play out. It's less about being showy and stylistic and more about being in the moment and reacting to something biotic, something visceral.
Yeah, this one feels, it has that kind of almost what I call this kind of documentary feel to it, that you would feel maybe like with something like one of those old William Friedkin films, you know, that like, it doesn't feel, it's not as stylish as his other films, you know? And it's like, I think Alex Cox might take it seriously because of the fact that, of the setting, and because, you know, with Repo Man and like Sid and Nancy and Walker, like he had some, you know, they're the worlds he was dealing with were kind of absurd.
Mm-hmm.
But here he like, I think it takes his, you know, I mean, he has a great affection for Mexico, but I think he takes it very seriously. You know, I think he feels pretty sorry for just what kind of country it is and how hard it is. And, you know, he's not making fun of it at all.
I think he feels incredibly empathic towards this culture. And it's not necessarily in the foreground, but there is a little hint of frustration towards America's lack of care and consideration for the war on drugs at the time. Because, again, just, you know, even if it's a quick scene, it's hurling a bottle of tequila at George Bush on the TV. And honestly, we all wanted to hurl bottles of tequila at George Bush and his son, for that matter.
Yes. So five stars.
Yeah, essentially. That's the moment I was like, okay, perfect. Perfect movie. But no, even the way, like, the final confrontation plays out, it did remind me of, like, Breaking Bad in its unpredictable nature and just, you know, anything can happen. What's going to, how are they going to confront each other? Who's going to go down? And it's a little bit of a satirical slant at the way things play out for Pedro in terms of, like, the boss never finding out what he really did with the drugs and him getting a promotion and a medal or something.
Yes. I mean, yes, I guess Alex Cox wants to kind of, you know, take a sly, what do you call it? He wants to kind of present the whole job as a highway patrolman as being a little bit ridiculous.
Yeah. Yeah, no, he does. He does. In the same way that Repo Men experience ridiculous ups and downs with their profession, the same thing happens here, where there are humorous moments, there are scary moments with, like, you know, car accidents. Man, the guy with the leg that was severed at one point.
Oh, yeah.
That was pretty messed up. But
yeah, you know,
I really liked following this character. I thought he was very likable.
Yeah, the acting is good all around. It's again, it's not like his earlier films. It's pretty, very, the acting is much more of that, in that kind of naturalistic kind of acting. You just let them act, let them perform, and there's no kind of, like, you know, again, he's not making a satire here, really. The actors are, and of course, they're all Mexican. This is not an English film. I think at some point they speak, isn't there some scene where they speak English?
I can't remember. Yeah, I think there might be.
There's some German guy in the bar. He's trying to sell them.
Yeah. Yeah, that's right. They give him German beer.
And the first, the guy is like, oh, his friend's like, you know, no, we drink Mexican. And then he drinks the Mexican. It's like, ugh. Then he drinks the German beer. And it's...
Maybe that's Alex Cox's, again, way of inserting some political commentary. Mm. You know, or just at least the way people interact with each other from different cultures.
Yeah. You know, that's what I really dig about Alex Cox being this kind of rebellious and very outsider filmmaker. But, you know, unlike the ones who came around in the 90s, and I'm thinking, like, you talk about Mexican, you know, film. Like, look at Robert Rodriguez, who just, you know, just went out of her way to make stylish action films. Really.
Yeah, another guy who could have been influenced by Repo Man.
Yeah, and probably maybe Straight to Hell, you know.
Yeah. Yeah, no, definitely.
But it feels like, you know, that's why I kind of like him a bit more than, you know, Rodriguez or Tarantino. Like, he has something, he wants to, you know, I love the fact that he actually, like, cares about these countries. And he wants to say something. And he wants to bring up the fact that, you know, look at these countries and look how bad they are. You know, he's not simply out to make, you know, oh, I'm going to try and make the next, you know, Repo Man or something. Make something like that. No, he wants to go further, go in different directions. And he wants to address these issues, you know.
And yeah, he doesn't romanticize, you know, the countries he's in or their locales or even the characters. I mean, as likable as Pedro is, he does make some impulsive and sloppy decisions throughout this movie, including getting involved with a prostitute.
Yeah, that does not end.
And the way that ends, it's very bittersweet, where it's like, okay, I've at least gotten out of a dead-end career, but now I'm kind of a slave to these two women in a way. You know, it's I don't know. I wouldn't say it's got kind of a narrow view on women, but, you know, there is kind of like the overbearing Mercedes Rule kind of woman as the wife, and, you know, the prostitute with the heart of gold kind of approach to the woman he's having an affair with.
Sure.
So it's a little narrow-minded in that regard. But that's kind of minor because we are focusing primarily on Pedro's... You know, it's essentially a character study, and that's something I hadn't seen done this way from Alex Cox yet.
No, it's very interesting. And the filmmaking here, it's fascinating that the use of one takes, that's not easy.
No, definitely not.
I mean, and there at some point, there's a scene, it's a funny behind-the-scenes story where there's a scene where he has to shoot a dog. There's rabies, you know.
Oh, right, yeah. That's one of my favorite moments.
Yeah, which is, you don't see it get shot, it's actually off-screen. But they had a dog, and the guy with the dog said, okay, you got three dogs, so you got three takes. It's like, and Cox is like, wait, I'm not gonna shoot the dog. And then,
no, you know, this isn't Cannibal Holocaust, people.
No, but the Mexican really fought. He was like, he's gonna shoot the dog.
The best thing is, like, the second he shoots the dog, everyone in the community just starts applauding. And then, like, a woman comes up to him and he's like, you're gonna pay me for the chicken that you shot.
Yeah, it's just that there's where the humor comes in, of course.
Yeah, that's the moment of levity throughout all the craziness taking place is pretty spectacular.
Yeah, and it works. I mean, it's like, oh yeah, there are going to be these absurd moments, you know.
Yeah, because it's Alex Cox, and that's kind of what I like about him the most is his sense of humor. But here again, playing in a mostly dramatic, serious realm, he pulls it off quite beautifully. Like, when he finds his friend dying in his arms, it's really emotional. There's nothing funny about that at all, because he set the tone so well from the start that you kind of just you go along with this character through thick and thin. And this is a fascinating world that you don't normally get to see too, so I really, really appreciate you making sure I see this.
Yeah, I told you to see it like at the yesterday. Like, you gotta check this one out because it's one of Alice Cox, like, really one of his more unusual films.
Speaking of unusual, we're gonna pretty much end on one final conversation with three businessmen.
Yeah, I can just, first of all, I recommend.
Oh, you can talk about the winner, too, real quick, if you wanted to.
I just want to he made a film, it was made for BBC. It was called Death and the Compass.
Oh, right. Sorry. Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, which was originally supposed to be like 15 minutes long, but then he got some more he got some funding from the Japanese guys, and he was allowed to make it into a 90-minute film. It's this really bizarre film. I didn't quite know what to make of it. Like, it's not in terms of like good or bad necessarily, but like I was watching this going like, is this supposed to be like a Blade Runner science fiction film? Because it's so, the style of the film is so strange. What's the name of it? We just talked about him, the actor. Young Frankenstein. What's his name?
Peter Boyle.
Yeah, plays a detective in the film who's trying to solve this strange murders happening in the city. And it's based on a short story that's like 30 pages long. And so he's taking a short story and really dragged it out. And he, in this film, Alice Cox is doing that one take thing that he did with Highway Patrolman. And there are some very odd things. I recommend checking it out because it was fascinating to watch, I must say. Christopher Eccleston is in the film. And the actor who's in Free Businessmen is in the film as well. Who plays, the guy with the mustache. What's his name?
Miguel Sandoval or something, I think.
Yeah, he's in the film. So, yeah, I recommend checking that one out. Definitely Compass. That was a weird one.
I like weird.
The winner, which was supposed to be this, I guess it was supposed to be this attempt to go back into mainstream.
Phil was an ordinary guy with an extraordinary gift for making money.
He's been on a winning streak for 5 weeks and he hasn't lost once.
I love this guy. I just get so damn lucky.
Now,
a lot of people want your lover boy to lose.
He is not gonna lose.
The girl wants to marry him.
We're in this together.
Why do you only play on the Sundays?
The mom wants to kill him.
Well, I owe some people a lot of money.
Wings.
$500,000.
And his brother just wants a piece of the pie.
Why did you come?
I came with Dad. He's dead.
Somebody shot him dead?
It looks like a very Tarantino kind of ripoff. Right.
Yeah. The cast, when you have Michael Madsen, I'm just like, all right, straight to video Tarantino ripoff.
Yeah, I've seen Tarantino. I mean, like, for example, what's it called? Things to Do in Denver When You're Dead.
Yeah, and then there's 2 Days in the Valley. There's others.
Yeah, this one has that kind of like, okay, this was probably greenlit because of Pulp Fiction or whatever. But it is, you know, I watch him going like, okay, this was recut by the studio. But it's all done in one takes, again. And it has that Alice Cox vibe to it at times. There is that sense of satire to it. He's trying to make fun of Las Vegas. But it is kind of a mess, unfortunately. There are some stylistic moments here and there. There's a really cool stylistic moment in Death and the Compass I have to talk about. There's like a scene with Peter Boyle sitting in his office or something, and the background is completely dark. But then the phone rings, and he picks up the phone, and it's Christopher Eccleston. And suddenly the background, you start to see Christopher Eccleston in the background. It lights up.
Oh, that's kind of cool.
Yeah, I was like, oh, it's unusually stylistic.
Yeah.
So yeah, sometimes he'll try to be a little flashy occasionally. And you know, he is a net filmmaker who occasionally will do something like that, you know. So I like those little sparks of like, oh yeah, you can see like Alice Cox, he's trying to do something here, you know. Like in The Winner also, it's a point where like this guy's in the jail cell and he's talking to the guard, and suddenly the guard just looks up, and suddenly there's this flash of white light, and suddenly the guard has like this crazy hair, and he's like, I'm not gonna let you out or something. And then he comes back to him. Just this weird, like, whoa, what was that? So yeah, but yeah, the Alice Cox in the 90s, this is where he is not making mainstream movies anymore. He is making these low-budget films. And he's entered into this, like, style of doing everything in one takes, which is how Free Businessmen was shot.
Good segue.
Yeah.
No, it's very true.
It's like a quirky little travelogue across Liverpool.
Shifting markets.
Oh, absolutely. It's economic revitalization.
That's the key, isn't it?
It has to be. It must be.
And we're on the edge of it, Frank, the cutting edge, the independent businessman.
Once it gives you access to what you need, when you need it, only then will you be on the path to personal and professional success.
Hear, hear, well said.
But it's also part My Dinner with Andre with a little bit of Waiting for Godot. Like, the way they meet initially over dinner in this hotel restaurant, I was like, okay, is this going to be the movie where they're just sort of waiting and hanging out? And why the heck, for no reason, does the hotel staff, the restaurant staff, do they just disappear? Like, because they both order dinner and then nobody comes for a very long period of time.
That is very, very strange moment, because they're sitting there in the hotel at the beginning and they hear like the sound of like what appears to be something dropping on the floor. They hear like this metallic sound, and then you look and they're gone. And I could not make any sense out of that. I don't know what was going on there. Maybe there's something that's guiding them.
You know what this movie feels like? A dream. Yeah. It feels like a weird, surreal dream, but yet it has very naturalistic conversations, like I mentioned, the kind you'd find in a Richard Linklater movie, where two characters just met each other, and they're sort of learning how to connect through conversation, and these conversations are filmed in master shots without any breaks or cuts, and you know, every scene, there's an establishing shot, but they're also... no standard shot, reverse shots.
Yeah. What do you think of that style, actually?
I like it. I do. I mean, it depends on the material, but I do have an affinity for these types of movies where two characters meet, they're not necessarily like-minded, but they try different ways to, you know, connect. Mm. Whether they're just trying to decide on where to eat or, like, sort of mundane random things. Like, this is not a plot driven movie. It's very episodic, and I kind of like that approach once in a while. It's not something I want to see every time I go to the movies, but in the midst of Alex Cox's filmography, this is kind of an anomaly, I guess, because it really is just about, like, the journey is the destination with two characters. And I'm also thinking, well, where the hell is this third businessman gonna show up?
Yeah, it takes a long time.
Indeed. But yeah, like the score and the striking portrayal of Liverpool and just the weird places they wind up and the weird interactions they have. Like, at one point they go to a Chinese restaurant and they give them the fake food that's in the window. Yeah, and I like their interaction together. It's also interesting to see just Alex Cox as an actor in this.
Yeah, he's been in some of his other earlier films as well. He shows up in actually I saw him in The Winner, which was funny. He was in that. He plays a Frenchman, and then Rebecca De Mornay walks up and goes, "What's up with that guy? Does he really think he can fool anybody with his French accent?"
That's his sense of humor again.
Yeah, he's definitely a better actor than Tarantino. I can say that about him.
I mean, this movie is slow, but not in a way I found boring.
It's kind of, again, that kind of hangout film, I would say.
Yeah.
It is just watching these two characters. And Miguel, again, Miguel...
Sandoval.
Sandoval, he is just, I mean, wonderful, the film.
Mm-hmm.
Talking about
he's so friendly.
Yeah.
But kind of like in an overbearing way at times.
Yeah, he's so dependent on Alex Cox. Like, just around and trying to find his way around Liverpool. And then trying to, like, there's so many funny... There's like one scene I thought of that reminded me of American Psycho, where they're talking about, like, business cards.
Yeah, I can see that.
Yeah, but of course, then it brings up the plutonium. Is that the plutonium card?
Oh, right.
He's like, I can call. Yeah, you just call and they'll fix everything or something. You know,
what is it's it weird because like I feel like they, I don't know. They both feel like they're playing a role within the movie. Like they're trying to say that they're these businessmen, but maybe there's something else. I don't know.
Yeah, you're waiting for some kind of twist to happen.
Yeah, but maybe it's just that they're just lost souls, you know, trying to navigate through this world, and it's weird how they wind up where they wind up at the end, and that's when we meet the third businessman.
Yeah, it's interesting that this film kind of ends up where, like, for example, Straight to Hell begins.
Yeah, totally.
Alex Cox has some, I mean, in some ways also Highway Patrolman, like, and actually at the end of Death and the Compass as well, they end up at this, just in the desert, in the mountains, or something. Like, just,
yeah, and like the third businessman is from Chicago, and at the very end, like, they all point in different directions and go, oh, look, there's Chicago, there's Lakeshore Drive. I'm like, what? That's so weird. It's just a weird ending. Like, I didn't love it. It was more of a head-scratcher, but not in a way I would say was bad.
Mm. It's got some, again, just how I can recommend to Alex Cox, to people who want to see Alex Cox films, just they're funny. And yeah, there are funny moments in this one they're at the restaurant and they're gonna have dinner and suddenly he has a panic attack,
right?
Miguel Sandoval, and he runs out and suddenly like he starts to then it becomes really Monty Python and he like speeds up the footage.
Mm-hmm.
You notice that,
right?
And it's like he's wailing his arms around and going ah.
It's like Benny Hill all of a sudden.
Yeah, and then he falls on the ground and Alex Cox is like kind of like, you know what happened, and it's like there was so much food.
And I like when he's sitting in his hotel room and he's trying to read all these different books. One's called like The Multi-Orgasmic Man.
Oh yeah, that's right.
And the other is like Things You Never Knew Existed. So it's just it's just a surreal, weird conversational comedy.
Yeah, you got to give this to Alex Cox. He is unique, and he never makes the same movie, really.
That's probably the best thing you can say. I mean, like, there's a lot of reasons why to admire and appreciate his work.
Yeah.
But
even if you don't like him, you can. I think anybody will say, yeah, he is original and unique, and he doesn't repeat himself.
Right. And, you know, you can view his work as satire or sort of deconstructions of the way people interact and the way we sort of negotiate relationships with other cultures. You can certainly find all these different interesting elements, but you can also just look at his films aesthetically, or like I mentioned with the cinematography, it's just they look completely original, and they have great touches throughout, especially Repo Man and Sid and Nancy and Walker. They're even if he's tackling kind of like a biopic, he doesn't do it traditionally in any sense of the. I mean, like, I'll take a Walker over a Walk Hard. I mean, over Walk the Line, I should say. Or Ray, you know, like those. Just sort of Oscar Beatty biopics.
Oh yeah, oh yeah. And I'm, you know, I'm like looking forward to anything that he has in the works. I mean, Tombstone Rashomon. I hope it will be some kind of maybe comeback for him in the in the world. You know.
Yeah, like fingers crossed.
I want to see him do something more. I think he has. I think he probably has some more movies in him. I like to think so.
He does. He seems to still have a lot of energy. I mean, he has obviously become very jaded and cynical about Hollywood, as well he should.
Yeah.
But, I think he could still utilize something like Kickstarter.
Yeah, and how he lives. I think when I see him in like some interviews, I think he just lives out in a cabin. somewhere in the woods. Like, yeah, that's how he lives. He's just kind of isolated. And Alice Cox, please come back. We all miss you.
I completely concur with that 100%. And as a fan of both Rashomon and Tombstone, if you're going to mash those up, I'm all for it.
There was another film I didn't see. I have it on DVD. I wish I had time to see it, but it was called Revengeous Tragedy from 2002.
Yeah. I know he's got a couple others like Searchers 2.0.
Yeah, but this looks like a real film, so it could maybe be something to check out. So.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, and I like that he's anti-establishment, sort of counterculture, but he portrays it respectfully.
Yeah.
He doesn't like, I mean, he'll poke fun, but like he pokes fun at Scientology and Repo Man and Christian conservatism and all sorts of different things. But I think he also doesn't take his own views too seriously, which is great because you should have reverence and a playfulness about the way you approach material.
Yeah, and I'm looking at this credits here. I see that he is... he's credited for Fear and Loathing Las Vegas. He wrote the screenplay. I think he was going to direct that, actually.
I think he was also going to direct Three Amigos, which would have been great.
Oh, yeah, that's right. Yeah, so it's like, yeah, kind of his career is, it's a bit of a missed opportunity in some ways that he didn't get to maybe go further. I mean, Walker definitely, it's one of those cases where, like, I wonder what would happen if Walker had been a success, you know, like where his career would have gone
after that. Maybe like a Paul Verhoeven kind of trajectory for his career, maybe.
I think he's even said that, like, oh yeah, I could have been the next maybe Paul Verhoeven, you know, could have been that maybe.
Maybe that I heard that and it seeped into my subconscious and that's why I thought that. Let's give our top three Alex Cox films.
Okay,
what would be yours? I'll let you go first this time.
Number one, I'd probably say Repo Man. It's just such an enjoyable film.
Of course.
Number two, I'll probably say Walker, because that movie is just so awesome.
Batshit weird at times.
Yeah, just so relevant still to this day. And then I probably would say maybe either Highway Patrolman or maybe Sid and Nancy. I'm not sure. A little split there.
Yeah, that's a tough call. Number three for me, that's the weird, I sort of feel the same way. But, I mean, I guess I'm going to go Walker for number three. Number two, Highway Patrolman. And number one, Repo Man. That's just how I feel right now. But, I think it's more just like Highway Patrolman was a genuine surprise at how involved I was with it and... You know, I mean, it's certainly not as crazy or surreal as some of his other films, or it doesn't have that sort of manic energy of Sid and Nancy, but I just like that I got to watch kind of a conventional character study, and, you know, it's from a different country, too.
Yeah, it's kind of like, again, it's kind of like the same with Tarantino, with Jackie Brown, like, look, I can do something else. I'm not just somebody who makes big, flashy, like... incredibly stylish films. I can also make conventional films.
Well, thanks a lot for being on the show, Philip. I really enjoyed talking with you, man.
Oh, thank you for having me on. I hope I was able to be a good guest. And maybe.
You'll be welcome back next year for sure. Let's see. Where can people find more of your work online if they're curious to read or follow you in any way?
You can check out my blog, which is the Swedish Cinemasochist podcast, and skip the podcast maybe. But you can follow me on Twitter, Hollow Shape. You can maybe even follow me on Facebook if you will. That's perfectly fine. That's where you can find me. And I don't know what's going to happen to me now next year. I don't know if I'll be working maybe in film, or now that suddenly I got a friend who wants to make short films with me. I'll be heading somewhere.
Yeah, that'd be great. Yeah, so our next episode is actually going to be in a week because I managed to just jam-pack August, the beginning here, which is totally great because, you get a little bit more Director's Club before my break in September.
Yeah.
But, yeah, the next episode is on James Cameron.
Oh.
Which is a kind of a complete flip side to Alex Cox in terms of budget. And I'm not even the biggest James Cameron fan, but there are some incredible films from his filmography that I'm excited to talk about with former guest Eric Childress, who just tends to be my sort of summer blockbuster escapist entertainment go-to guest, because he was on for Spielberg and Christopher Nolan and Robert Zemeckis, so it only feels appropriate that he should be on for James Cameron as well.
I think I like Terminator and Aliens probably the best of his. Those are the films I just look at and go, wow, these are so well made. And then you get to something like Avatar, and it's like, I don't know about this.
Yeah, yeah, no, that's but, we'll definitely be bringing that up.
But
you'll be back next year, and I really appreciate you coming on the show. People, you can check out directorsclubpodcast.com and send me an email at directorsclubpodcast@gmail.com. So thanks again for being on the show.
Thank you for having me.
All right. We'll talk to you soon for the James Cameron episode. Goodbye, everybody.
There's a parking lot viper alone in the dream. A fabulous disaster of an underground queen. She never took no for an answer. Never took no for an answer. Can sometimes be fooled, crashing to earth as they reach for the moon, and never take no for an answer.
The best thing is, like, the second he shoots the dog, everyone in the community just starts applauding. And then, like, a woman comes up to him and he's like, you're gonna pay me for the chicken that you shot.
Crystal meth, Pepsi.